around the series which you have about the Holy Spirit, who is the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit and us as I see the Holy Spirit, the role of the Holy Spirit in the church as a whole. I'm going to talk about some points quickly. What is the relation of the Holy Spirit in the church? To start with.
Thank you.
Thank you. To start with, let me refresh your mind about the Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descended upon the apostles. And for sure, the heaven was going to be mentioned there. Just to refresh your mind. The Holy Spirit descended on the apostle on the day of Pentecost, as you know. And Pentecost is a very great Jewish feast. What did they celebrate in this feast? Actually, they call it the Feast of Weeks. Pentecost means 50. Feast of Weeks, or Feast of Harvest, because they used to start to collect the harvest for 7 weeks. And at the end of this harvest, on the day 50, they offer the first fruit to God. What is the first fruit? The grains of wheat. They put water in it and make it like loaves and bread and offer this bread to God as first fruit of the harvest. After a while, they added another event. His feast. What is the event? In Jewish tradition, that the Moses received the law from God, received the Ten Commandments from God, after 50 days from there crossing the Red Sea. Are you with me? So, it is a feast of harvest, and at the same time, they call it the Feast of God's Covenant. Because God's covenant is the commandments which they received by Moses. When Moses received the Ten Commandments, as you know, they went in Sinai in the desert, and Moses went up in the mountain, and what happened? There was a great sound, lightning, fire, an earthquake, and then God gave Moses the commandments. Am I right? I believe he is Peter and go in the feast of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit is sent upon the apostles. What happened? I think the same. Great sound, white wind, together, tongues of fire, and the Holy Spirit descend upon all of them and fill them. Am I right? That's why we can consider what happened on that day is a new Sinai. What happened in Sinai in the Old Testament? Again, it is repeated, but in another way in the New Testament. And actually, the covenant of God here is not just words written by His Son. What's His covenant? His Spirit Himself is going to descend and to fill the apostles. The first thing exactly what they used to do in harvest. He said that the believers at the time, the believers, I mean, there were 120 people in this house when the Holy Spirit descended upon them. The apostles and Saint Mary were in the upper room, and the other people are occupying with the believers. The rest of the 120 people are in the rest of the house. And the Holy Spirit descended upon all of them and defeated all of them. Saint Irenaeus said that the Holy Spirit at this day did a very important action. The believers are like grains of wheat, and the Holy Spirit is like water. And this is one of the symbols of the Holy Spirit, actually. So he made the grains of wheat, and he makes this flower, he made it into a dough. It means it became a shape. And this shape became the body of Christ. And the Christ was the head. And this shape, this body, became a church. That's why we say that the first action of the Holy Spirit on the day that he started the church was born on that day by the action of the Holy Spirit. So the first action of the Holy Spirit is to form the church in itself. Saint Irenaeus said that wherever the church is, the Spirit of God is also there. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, the church is also there. Saint Augustine says, what I'm saying about what I'm talking about, he said that what the soul is to man's body, the Holy Spirit is to the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is the church. The Holy Spirit does in the Holy Church what the soul does in the members of one body. So the first action, the first role of the Holy Spirit in the church actually is to form the church. And if you notice here that what the Jews they used to do in Pentecost is it repeated here in the New Testament. They celebrated the Pentecost as a feast of harvest and a feast of God's covenant. Feast of Harvest, as I said, they gathered the harvest, Feast of Covenant, because they received the Moses' law. Again, what happened in the New Testament is the same. God's covenant here is the Holy Spirit Himself, and the harvest is us, the believers, who became one unit, one body, to form the church. And this is the first and the important action of the Holy Spirit. What else? The Holy Spirit in the church is the source of teaching. What I mean by source of teaching? The whole Bible, the whole Word of God, which we receive, comes from you. Comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit inspired people and they wrote down what we have learned. So the source of teaching mainly comes from the Holy Spirit. And this is what St. Peter said in his epistle. for prophecy, never down by the will of man, but when the men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit uses until now the word which He produces for us to teach us again. And He gives us the word, and He uses this word to teach us. And I will tell you something very, very attractive actually about teaching. One of the main roles of the Holy Spirit in the church is to meet our Lord Jesus present as a source of teaching in every liturgy we do or we pray. This is His role. So every teaching we get, it should be from the mouth of our Lord Jesus Himself. He makes the presence of our Lord Jesus His immediate and continuous presence inside the church. If you go to Old Cairo, Muslim Medina, and you visit the church in there, you will find out that we don't do it in our churches now. Something called Imbid. Imbid, that is a high stage based on 12 columns, and the person to get to this high stage, he should, there is a stairs. He should walk on the stairs to reach the top to stand there. They use it for what? They use it, the priest or the whoever is going to give the sermon, he used to give the sermon from this emblem, from this high place. Wow. Actually, because it reminds us of our Lord Jesus when He went up in the mountain to give His sermon, as it is written, the sermon on the mountain, as it is written in Matthew 5, 6, 7. So the concept in the church that who is going to give us now the sermon, as if the Lord Jesus Himself is going to teach us, and through the Holy Spirit, because this is the action of the Holy Spirit, to make the presence of our Lord Jesus immediate and continuous during the service. Is it clear? Mentor, yes. Have you slept too much? Another point about teaching. St. John in his epistle said a very important verse about heresies and when we have a strange teaching. He said, well, but you have an anointing from the Holy One. Anointing, when you are anointed with oil, you receive the Holy Spirit from the Holy One, from the Holy Spirit. And you know all things. You know everything. Yusuf. And you know all things. So, when we are anointed with the Holy Spirit, we have to know all things. What does this mean? It means that when I receive any strange teaching, any heresy, when I hear it for the first time, I can say, this is wrong. How can I reach this limit? It's by the Holy Spirit. But usually, we don't have this skill. Because we need two things. We need first to know, and to know the basis about our doctrine, And second, and the most important thing, which I'm talking about, to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Because to be filled by the Holy Spirit is a continuous process. And we took the Holy Spirit during our baptism. And this is the second sacrament of the church. We had it, and He will never leave us. But to be filled with Him, it's a continuous process. And we can be filled now, and filled after a week, and after a year, and so on. When we reach this level, to be filled by the Holy Spirit, it will be easy for us to say, no, this is wrong. Yes, I agree with this opinion. St. Paul, in his epistle to Ephesians, he said that, be filled with the Holy Spirit. How can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? Speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs is number one. Things in I have to go deep in my prayer. Singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submitting to one another in fear of God. All what St. Paul mentioned here is a way to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Our Lord Jesus Himself. Our Lord Jesus Himself, when He spent 40 days in the desert, praying and fasting, what the Bible said about Him after that? The Bible says, you can find Gospel of Luke chapter 4, He said that Jesus, full of the Spirit, returned from Jordan and was led around by the Spirit in the wilderness. So our Lord Jesus gave us an example of how to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Just go to the deep in your relationship with God. Just pray with Him. Just have more and more quiet time. And this is the second action, the second work of the Holy Spirit in the church. So the first one, He starts the church. The second one, He's responsible for the teaching in the church. The third one, He is the leader of the church. What I mean by leader of the church? He is the one who appoints this man to be a patriarch here, and this one to be a bishop here, and this one to be a priest here, and this one to be a servant here, and this one to be a YRM servant, and this one to be out of the YRM, and so on. He is responsible for the arrangement of the service. He is a leader. هو أحسن بدل هنا أني أصير أني فرانسيس عشان ما تمنوش راس سويسا. Can you read for us? Acts 13, verse 2 and 3. I say loud voice, please, and stand up. Thank you, Amos. Acts 13, verse 2 and 3.
As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Then having fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they took them away.
Thank you. So, who chose Saul and Barnabas? In some respect, he appointed. When He give the role of any one of us what he should do. But before leaving this point, I just want to ask a question. The Holy Spirit said to them, separate for me Paul and Barnabas. my question is, how did they hear the voice of the Holy Spirit? How did they hear it? What are you?
Saying, come over to Macedonia and help us.
Thank you. disciples were preaching in Asia. And suddenly the Holy Spirit prevented from carrying on preaching in Asia. And they tried again, and the Holy Spirit, for the second time, he prevented them. Until some Paul saw a vision. A man from Macedonia telling him, come to us and preach in our land. And Macedonia was the first part in Europe. So the Holy Spirit wanted them to leave Asia for a while and to go to Europe to start preaching in Europe. Then you see how the Holy Spirit leads us and arranges the service. And this is one of the most important actions of the Holy Spirit in the church. Because the Holy Spirit begins the church, the Holy Spirit is the source of teaching, and the Holy Spirit is the leading of the church. What says? When you become a little thing, God has mercy. One of the main actions of the Holy Spirit that he makes us one, even at the example which I mentioned at the beginning, you are grains of wheat, and the Holy Spirit is like water, and he makes us like a woman, to have a sheep, to make us one. Of course, we become one, to become a church. But here I am talking about it's very important for us to be one in unity, in one accord. And even when the Holy Spirit descends upon the apostles, he descends on them in which form? Which form the Holy Spirit is sent to the apostles? Tongues of fire. Yes? Only tongues of fire? Wind. He starts with wind. Why wind? Wind because the air, when it comes with the wind, it fills all of us equal. Okay? It means that we are all one. And then tongues of fire, different from every one of them, because every one of them will have his character, will have his gift. That's why we believe in the church that, of course, we are individuals, but more than that, we are members, and we can complete each other, and we know that. What St. Paul said, an arm and an eye and all this. So we complete each other. And this is the value of the Holy Spirit. And here I want to tell you something very important. Everyone try to make division in the church, in a family, or wherever. Actually, it's working with Satan. Why? Because Satan is the first one to make division. The first division Satan made between man, Adam and Eve, and God. So keep this in mind. It's very important.
That's why it's called divide and conquer.
And a lot of the stories here, I can tell you about unity, but I will tell you only one or two stories. In the era of Pope Corollus the fifth, not the sixth. At the time, in the patriarchy, was a gardener. But this gardener used to water the plants of the patriarchy early in the morning. And he was a very holy man. He said that while he is watering the plants, he used to see San Mark himself standing beside him. And once, while he was watering the garden, he couldn't see San Mark. The day after, he couldn't see San Mark. So he became very sad. And he went to the Pope himself, he went to the Pope Corona the Fifth, and said to him, Sayyid, I want to confess you something. Yes, I used to see some work, but now I can't see. Maybe I am a sinful man, maybe I did something wrong, but I can't see anymore. Pope Corona the Fifth said to me, good man, and I will need you to come again to discuss this. Pope Corollus started to ask about what is going on in the particular case. Until he discovered that there are two priests are in conflict with each other. So he brought them, he got them to come to him, and actually he solved the issue. The day after, he asked the gardener to come and said to him, did you start to see some mark again? And yes, yesterday I started to see him again. I want you to be sure that in any service, in any group, whatever marvelous activity they have, if there is no unity, the Holy Spirit is not working well. Whatever the activity is. I learned from my Sunday school teachers when I was younger. Okay? I learned from them that it's better, even in the service, to cancel a service completely, to cancel an activity completely, to keep unity rather than to do the service, to do the activity, and to make a unity. Another story, it happens with Pope Corona the Sixth, which all of us know. Once someone came to Pope Corona the Sixth and said to him, Sayyidna, there is something very strange in one of the churches. What happened in the church? Actually, one of the columns of the church. Has a crack and it is oozing blood. So Pope Corollos asked his disciple Ghulam Fa'il to go there and see what is happening. And he said to him, Sayyidna, this is actually what is happening. And when he started again to ask, he found that the two priests in his church are not in one accord. Have some conflict between them. And the blood stopped oozing from the column of the church when the two priests became married and made a sign. So the Holy Spirit again originated the church, the Holy Spirit being the second point. What's the second point I mentioned? You said?
Ephesians.
Third point? The leader of the church. And the last point is?
Unity.
Unity. Unify us and the church. Another point. The Holy Spirit actually has a great role in evangelism. That's why our Lord Jesus said to his disciples, don't leave Jerusalem until you get a power from God, until you get the Holy Spirit. And after that, you start preaching. Don't start preaching before that. One of the lovely saying, I found about this, it said the mission to evangelize the world could only be undertaken with the power of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we can't reach. That's why St. Peter, after he sent the Holy Spirit on them, on him, by a simple sermon, if you analyze the sermon of St. Peter on the day of Pentecost, you will find it, but because it is touched by the Holy Spirit, he attracted how many people? How many people?
3,000.
A fisherman attracted 3,000 people because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. So without the Holy Spirit, we can't reach. The last point about the Holy Spirit has a big role in the sacraments of the Church. We're not going to discuss the sacraments, every sacrament, what the Holy Spirit, what is the role of the Holy Spirit in each sacrament, because I think you know that. But by the way, I like what one of the fathers said. It's better to call it mystery than sacrament. Be mystery. When mystery means there is something hidden we can't see is happening. But the Holy Spirit is doing an action we can't see. That's why it is mystery. What is the saying, lovely saying from this? It said, the Holy Spirit gives us a church and she in turn gives us the mysteries. And I will conclude with what St. Augustine said about it. He said that what the soul to man's body, the Holy Spirit is to the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is the Church. The Holy Spirit does in the Holy Church what the soul does in the members of one body. I think this is the main six actions of the Holy Spirit to the Church. Can I ask you that to repeat it together? I'm going to ask someone to stand up and to tell me one of the roles of the Holy Spirit, not just the title, but the summary of what I said. Here I go. Can I do that in 5 minutes? I'm a 6 points. But what point that would mean? Okay? Agree? Who doesn't agree? As you're smiling, when you're smiling, you are agreeing with what I'm saying. But, send it. 6 points.
There's a conflict, there's a disagreement that was going to be present in the church. So,
thank you. instead of social teaching. Me, yes.
The mystery.
Spirit rather than against it. slaves to death. Right? We wouldn't all need Jesus Christ to come to the cross. So the more we try and alienate God out of the equation, the more we alienate ourselves from the gifts of the Holy Spirit, which is comfort, unity, joy, all of this stuff.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's the story of the
Kevuna. Sylvia, can you tell us what's next? Who's speaking next week?
Next week we have a very special guest. We have some of you know some of the guys, Bessie Morris.
Yes.
He used to live here. He's Australian, and then he is one of our best lovely ladies. Married her and went back to Australia, but they're visiting at the moment. I can guarantee you it'll be a wonderful talk. So that's next week, and also. And then if you know Martina, Mary and Rachel, Grandma passed away last week, so there's a memorial at the church from 2:30 to 4:30. So if you'd like to just go and pay your condolences to the church.
Guys, can we stand up to pray, Sylvie, if you can close us with a prayer?